my name is Edith Beigne, so I'm working at CEA LETI. I'll take the opportunity of this talk to show you some interesting highlights on 3D technologies and how it can bring some flexible architectures. And I'll give you also some perspectives on how we can use this technology for brain-inspired computing. Of course, low power is still a big challenge, specifically for embedded circuits. And this is because we want more autonomy and we have some thermal issues in our circuits. Overall, there are still a lot of limitations due to variations affecting the circuit performances. These variations can be PVT variations, but also environmental variations. At each layer, as shown in this picture here, power is, of course, a challenge, and I'd like to focus my talk today mainly on end devices, but you will see that 3D technologies can be applied from the cloud layer down to the end devices. As we have a lot of variations and we want to reach this high energy efficiency for performance optimization, we need to have circuits that are flexible and adaptive. Adaptivity is required at all levels of abstractions from the technology up to the application. Of course, ideally, we would like to do that dynamically and in an automatic way. This is what we call auto-adaptive circuits. Most of the time, specifically for end devices, these devices are in unpredictable environments. So, of course, what we would like to have is smarter devices with embedded intelligence being able to adapt themselves to their environment, and this is what we call embedded intelligence and learning. Here is a view of what we can do in terms of flexibility and adaptivity in architectures. First of all, a lot of publications and a lot of works in products also have been done on architecture and design in 2D. Most of the time, what people are doing is adaptive voltage and frequency scaling to reach high energy efficiency. This is mainly applied to multi-cores, and also some architectural partitioning have been proposed for IoT systems. If we move now to more flexibility, I'd like to show you today how 3D technologies can be also a good way to have very flexible architectures, mainly focusing on communication and memory architectures. I'll show you after that some perspectives on embedded intelligence with learning, and I'll show you how we can also use 3D for efficient learning. First, let's focus on 3D architectures. I'd like to show here that we need to think about architectures that can be designed directly in 3D. Designing a circuit in 2D to bring it in 3D is not always the efficient way. So I'll show you here some specific architecture benefiting from 3D for high energy efficiency and to obtain a good partitioning of the architecture and also bringing to new memory architectures. So here is the view of the existing technologies 3D today. Here you have the view of the different 3D technologies that are available today. The first one on the left is through-silicon via or microbump with a pitch of 20 micrometer. Here we simply stack dies on the top of it. And the idea in terms of flexibility here is to have a kind of core partitioning. We can use different technologies to be stacked on the top of the others. And then, according to the requirements of the circuit, we can obtain different performances. In the middle here, the pitch is denser, and we can have a pitch around 1 micrometer. This is what we call high-density TSVs, or copper-to-copper. Here, we can start to think about new architectures with sub-block partitioning at kind of fine grain, and I'll show you how it is efficiently addressed, for example, for imagers. On the other side, on the right here, we see the more dense technology that we have today, which is 3D monolithic. We also call it cool cube at LETI, and the pitch is really, really small. We can think here to stack on the top of it transistors over transistors. So it will be really a high density interconnect, and some of our architecture can benefit from that. First example for TSVs. Here I'll show you an example applied on many cores for high performance computing and active interposer. Interestingly here, what we have is two layers with stacking different technologies. Why it is interesting? Because on the first stack, we can have power management with 65 nanometer, for example. And on the second stack, we can have more aggressive technology for digital computation. Something important in 3D, but also in many other circuits, is that we have a lot of thermal issues. So one of the challenges here will be to communicate the data from one stack to another. And we really won't want to distribute a clock, which is the same clock on the top layer and the bottom layer. The first reason is that we have different technologies. So what is proposed here in this work is to have a modular asynchronous 3D network on chip. And we can see on the top right of the slide here that the communication is automatically adapting the data rate to the temperature changes. So this is interesting because the data is automatically resynchronized with the asynchronous network on chip on different stacks, but also it is automatically adapting to the temperature variations. It can bring more scalability. We can think about a high number of cores. We have already demonstrated 96 cores. We here need full cache coherency to be able to have a really flexible system, but it is something that is increasing a lot the number of cores that we can have in a multi-core architecture. So going denser now, I'd like to show you how we can use efficiently the high-density TSVs for smart imagers. We have fabricated a two-layer 3D stacked backside illuminated vision chip. So on the top tier, what you have is the image sensor with the readout circuit. And on the bottom tier, you have the processors. Interestingly here, remember I was explaining about the partitioning. We can partition the system into a subsystem of macro pixel with only some pixels and a processor in the bottom. It means that directly the data coming from the image sensor can be computed fully in parallel by exploiting the infocal plane pixel readout circuit and increase a lot the frame rate per second. Here, something that we have obtained is more than 5,000 frames per second without reducing the ADC resolution. So this architecture is really benefiting from the high density 3D by allowing this parallel computation. If we are looking now at 3D monolithic, which is really, really dense, I'll give you just some perspectives here. Today, there are a lot of works targeting in-memory computing and processing in memory. However, if we want to have a lot of memory in that kind of architecture, it's interesting to think that we can stack on the top of the in-memory computing some non-volatile memories and have something that is very dense, performing some operation. In the bottom, we can still keep some processors performing some simple MAC operations. And here, we really think about a new architecture in terms of memory architecture, interleaving the in-memory computing and the usual processing in memory. Some systems have been demonstrated already in terms of technology for this technology. This is a monolithic nanosystem here, which has been demonstrated by Stanford, stacking on the top of it some carbon nanotube for interesting applications. So I went to 3D architectures. It's really important to show that the flexibility is different and the partitioning is different according to the density that we have in the interconnection. At any time, what is important to think is think 3D before designing an architecture. A 3D architecture is not a 2D design that we bring in 3D. The more the interconnections you have, the more the reconfiguration between interconnections you have, the more the 3D architecture will give flexibility and adaptivity. Some perspectives now. I'll talk about embedded intelligence and learning, and I'd like to show you here some perspectives on how the 3D technology can bring some new insights in the embedded intelligence. Learning is the best adaptivity that we can have because we know that the human beings are more than adaptive, they are intelligent. So this adaptivity, this ability to learn, we would like to bring it to end devices, but of course at low power cost. Why would we want to have end devices that are learning? Because this is fully event-driven, low energy, and we get a contextual information. So going back to 3D, if we think about a brain-inspired architecture, our brain is typically a 3D structure. Here I show a cortical column which is made of six layers. This is how the cortex is made in the brain. And really interestingly, if you look at a reptile cortical column, it only uses three layers. The reptile is able to make fast decisions, but not a lot of learning, not as much as human beings. If you can extend the number of layers and then extend the number of interconnections, you can think about a system that is able to learn more, at maybe at more energy cost, but learn more efficiently. So if we think again about these 3D technologies, we could really benefit from this kind of structure to build cortical columns that are not mimicking the brain, but that are inspired by the brain. On the right, something really interesting for 3D technologies is the evolution of the cortical column interconnections according to the age of a child. You see newborn, few interconnections, really easy. And when you're going to 2 years and even after that, there are more and more interconnections. Something more important than the number of interconnections is that these interconnections are reconfigured a lot during learning and for plasticity. This is important to understand here that 3D technologies with high density can really benefit from this kind of structure, and this is the basis of learning. So just perspectives to conclude this talk here is that if we think about 3D and if we think about embedded learning, probably designing 3D cortical columns in 3D could be a very efficient way to bring some more intelligence in end devices. So I went through these new ideas for adaptivity and flexibility. I hope you enjoyed it. So thank you for attending this talk. If you have any questions, please feel free to send me an email.